Hello everyone. Today we have our speaker here, Vera Mucaj. Vera is the Chief Scientific Officer at Datavon. And at Datavon, Vera leads a team focused on developing and defining key use cases for connecting health data in research, including driving the connection between clinical trial data and real-world data, which is something we're very curious to learn about. And the interim background, Vera has a very unique background. He's a research scientist by training and hold a bachelor in biochemistry from Harvard and PhD from cell molecular biology from University of Pennsylvania. Thanks for joining us, Vera, and floor is yours.
Awesome. Thank you. Thank you for having me and inviting me to speak today. So I'm going to be sharing a few slides, but I'd like for this conversation to be kind of like a two-party conversation. So feel free to interrupt me at any point and ask questions live. And I'll also make sure to leave quite a bit of time in the end for a bit of Q&A. I assume you're still able to see my slides, right?
Yes.
Excellent. So I thought I'd start the conversation with a little bit of background as to why I'm talking to you guys about healthcare data and AI, and a little bit more about that background, and then introduce a couple of ideas that are unique to the health data logistics problem around fragmentation, around not being able to have data in the right place at the right time. I want to introduce the concept of real-world data for the group in case folks are not familiar, and then tie it back to how healthcare data both can help improve AI models and AI products, and how AI itself can help improve healthcare data. In the end, I will talk a bit about some of the challenges around using AI in healthcare. And to close it up, I wanted to share a few kind of like a little bit silly, a little bit true predictions and ideas that I have about where the healthcare and AI world will go in the next decade or so. So without further ado, to get us started, as Jimin, thank you so much for the introduction there. Mentioned, my name's Vera. I've been at Datavon now for about 6 years. And for those of you who are not familiar with Datavon, we're a health technology company. We provide software and some services around data connectivity and exchange. We consider ourselves a data logistics company, and I'll explain what that means in a second. I'm calling you guys today from Philadelphia, Pennsylvania, where I've been for the last few years. I started at Datavon in San Francisco when we were a very small startup. I was employee number 8. Through a number of growth opportunities, including mergers, Datavon right now is a 7,000 plus people company. And I oversee our de-identified product development and a few use case solutions, both around how you can exchange de-identified healthcare data and how you can exchange medical record data for certain use cases. Started in basic research, and we can talk a little bit in the end about how one goes from doing completely basic science to frankly no science at all and a lot of technology. And on my free time, I enjoy doing sort of some of the standard, like being outside, reading a lot, keeping up with science and technology. It's a little ironic in one of these pictures here, I'm hugging a tree. We're in seasonal allergy season in Philadelphia right now, and trees are trying to kill me. So I apologize if I sound a little stuffy today, and I might at some point or another need to mute to cough a little bit. So apologies in advance for that. But to round out why sort of like Jimin and I got introduced pretty much via LinkedIn, and how I got into the AI and healthcare side of the world is actually from my research days when 10 plus years ago, I first started working in a lab. I was working using this technique called X-ray crystallography, which is actually a pretty onerous way, but the standard way to figure out how you can figure out the structure of a protein so you can learn more about its biology, so you can design drugs that can target a particular protein, et cetera, et cetera. And that problem is very difficult to solve in a bench science way, but technology like AlphaFold and others have more or less pretty much solved it by AI right now. So just that experience taught me that what 15 years ago would take a full PhD to really figure out the structure of one protein, and AI today can do in days or hours. It showed me really the importance of these new technologies and then how they can really transform science from basic to translational. In the world of health data, I've learned a little bit, and I want to share with you the power of how healthcare data itself can help improve AI models of the future. But one thing that I want to give as a disclaimer before getting started is that I am not an expert in AI. I'm an expert in healthcare data and basic and clinical biology. So I'm pretty sure that based on the lectures that you guys have been receiving so far, you know way more about AI and AI models than I do. So I might not be able to answer some of those questions. But to get us started on some of the premise here, one of the things that I strongly believe in is that we can have a universe where every decision in healthcare can be improved by data. You need the right data in the right place at the right time to be able to do so. And by some statistics, only 3% of healthcare data is useful today. That is because the data might sit in a place where researchers or end users might not access it. It might be because it's too difficult to make use of. Think like large genomic data, think unstructured doctor's notes. And it's also not used today because of certain fragmentation and siloization problems. And there is a huge issue when data is not accessible and used to make decisions. I like this slide and some of the examples here because I think complete healthcare data can help abrogate some of these problems, but I think also AI applications can help solve some of these problems. It's actually mind-boggling to know that in the US alone, there's 250,000 deaths that are caused by medical errors. So like just not looking at the a patient's history appropriately over time. If you're familiar with the rare disease space, or if you know folks in your life who have been underdiagnosed, misdiagnosed, or poorly diagnosed for a rare disease, you know that they deal with a long odyssey going from specialist to specialist to specialist before they get a diagnosis, let alone a treatment. And there's a lot of, in general, misdiagnosis and in some cases, underdiagnosis that happens across healthcare. And then finally, if you're looking to solve healthcare operations problems, a lot of the costs of healthcare have little to do with actually administering care, but a lot to do with the end-to-end process of healthcare operations. So when you're thinking about a company like Datavant, as I mentioned, we've been around for about a little over 6 years now. It's interesting, the first four bullets on the slide here were essentially what we had on the first day of Datavant. There was kind of a contention that we had about why a company like ours needed to exist and why there needed to be a way to create a health data network. So as I mentioned, the problem is not that there's not enough data out there in the world. The problem is that the data is not being used. It's not being used because the data doesn't sit in the right place and it doesn't sit together. There's a lot of reasons for why it doesn't sit together in one place, and we can talk about them. A lot of companies right now are trying to build on top of data. But in order to build on top of data, you need to build on top of good data. So what we decided to do, and we're pretty and are pretty single-minded to solve for, is to create the largest healthcare data ecosystem or healthcare data network. We operate in de-identified healthcare data exchange, data that's used for secondary use cases around research and analytics. In the United States, we're also the largest medical record retrieval company. So if you think about even yourselves as a patient, if you're going from one physician to another, let's say like me, you moved from San Francisco to Philadelphia, you want to make sure that your medical record moves with you as you see new primary care physicians or new specialists. And a lot of that work is done by companies like Datavant and others. So when I talk about, you know, what we do and what our technology does is I introduce ourselves as a data logistics company. So in whatever way, shape, or form, we bring technology that takes data from where it is to where it needs to be to satisfy certain use cases. So with that in mind, why do we have a big logistics and a big healthcare data fragmentation problem? I love this schematic because it actually can put it in practice, sort of like in your day-to-day lives as well. When I think about myself, I'm 37 years old. I'm relatively young, relatively healthy. And still, if I think about the last 5 years, I've had three different primary care physicians. My work changed my insurance almost every year. So I've had six different health insurances. I have seen specialists. I have seen generalist physicians. I've gotten blood work done at a Quest or a LabCorp, as well as at hospital systems. I wear a Fitbit, and there's lots of information about my health in that. There's other things that I do outside of the four walls of healthcare that impact my health. And when you think about where does all of this data for patient Vera Mucaj go, it goes into a number of different systems, different technologies, and in many cases, these systems don't talk to each other. So when I see a physician, they input information into their electronic health record. When I go to Quest, that goes into a lab system. When a physician prescribes me a certain medication, that will go into a pharmacy e-prescription system. Health insurance helps reimburse some of that through billing. If I were to enter a clinical trial, information about me as a participant in that clinical trial would be in other systems and sources. So just at the raw level where healthcare data is originating, you already start to see the problem. Even if you, frankly, like even if you're getting seen in the same health system for your entire life, you're going to have data sitting in different places. How do you get data from these places? How do you kind of marry the data together? And how do you do so in a privacy preserving way where needed is actually a pretty large problem. And there's lots of data aggregators, data analytics companies, and data connection companies like ourselves that are involved in making sort of like creating the full picture of me as an individual and then at the population level across many individuals. And using an example here, when you actually are trying to connect all of the data, let's say the example that I just gave or myself or this fictional patient here, not only do you have to deal with institutional issues like one EHR system or one hospital not talking to another, you have to also deal with systemic issues, as I mentioned, you know, like switching from one insurance to another. In the United States, no single insurance company has your entire medical history as you move around. There are cases where patients actually also don't receive care, full stop, and that creates gaps in their medical history. There are other factors that we're not kind of like discussing here today that have more to do with the fact that not everything that impacts your health is actually as a result of interactions that you have with the healthcare system. So there's a lot of choices that we make outside of the four walls of healthcare that impact our health just as much, if not more, than the time that we spend with physicians. Think of anything from where you choose to live. Is that a polluted area? Do you have to drive a lot to go to work? Are you more at risk of getting in a car crash, for example, and so on and so forth? So there's a lot of information out there that's being passively collected as you as a patient is encountering healthcare. There's a definition for this type of data, and I like this term because that's what we generally use in research. I'm curious, how many of you, if you could raise your hands, are familiar with the term real-world data or have encountered it before? See one hand. Great. So I see two. Awesome. I like this term because actually it is fairly all-encompassing and some people have different definitions, but the standard definition that I've heard is all of the data that is collected through normal healthcare activities or your day-to-day life that is outside of the confines of a randomized control clinical trial. And I'm using here a number of examples of where this data is. When I think about the data that I see my clients and I see my collaborators use in research and in other applications, some of the major healthcare data sources that I used for health economics research, for pharma research, et cetera, are around medical claims. And this is because medical claims are generated every time, you know, you have a provider having a conversation with a payer. There's a number of companies that kind of sit in the middle of that conversation that can have the rights to collect and connect that data. So a lot of research that's done today is done on open and closed medical claims data. Electronic health records data are also a pretty robust way to get healthcare information. However, electronic health records are a lot more fragmented today than claims data. Once you start looking at one data set, you can answer certain particular questions. Once you start connecting these data together, you can do things that are super interesting. So, for example, take electronic health record information, so your clinical information, and combine it to genetic testing or genomic data. Genomic data alone is very, very rich, but it's very difficult to put into context until you have the medical history of the patient. Once you combine EHR data with genomic data, you have what's called a clinical genomic data set, and you can do a lot more interesting research with it. You can answer a lot more relevant questions when it comes to clinical decision making, diagnosis, or drug development. Now, if you want to figure out what the like the cost outcome is of that data, then you may want to link medical claims data, which associates financial information to that data. So super interesting to see all of the different data sources that you can use for research and analytics. But to me, it becomes even more interesting when you start mixing and matching some of these data and combining these data together. And there's lots of companies out there in the world who do this today. So if you're interested in being in the healthcare data, healthcare analytics world, even after school, every single teeny tiny logo here, and sorry for the eye chart, is a potential company that you should be interested in, and that you probably will either collaborate with, be a partner of, or be a customer of. So lots of the data that I mentioned, like it gets originated in a number of different places. There's lots of intermediaries that aggregate this data, turn it into marketplace styles, turn it into analytics companies that are built on top of connected data. And then ultimately, there's a second part of this market outside of the data sources, which is the data users that use the data for different use cases. Under data users, I think a lot about pharma and life sciences. I think about payers and providers themselves. And I think about the analytic companies that serve those legs of healthcare. And finally, I think about the governments. Both in the US and outside of the US, the public sector is actually both a huge healthcare data generator and a huge healthcare data utilizer. A lot of the policies that we enjoy today are based on data that our government entities and our research agencies have been able to gather over the years. I put a link here to a blog post called The Fragmentation of Health Data, which I think has a little bit more detail about all of these different places where real-world data is generated and turned into more useful data. In the process of going from raw data to useful data, there's a lot of messiness. First of all, by the time you get to kind of an aggregated and usable data set, maybe that has some software on top of it that you can use for analytics, healthcare data has changed a lot of hands. And every time there's something that has happened to data, the data could be made better, but in some ways it could also be made worse. On the regulatory side, and we can talk sort of about some like regulatory grade use cases later, the farther you are from where the data originated, the more questions there are about the validity and the veracity of that data. There are things that might have happened to it that might have changed the flavor of the data or might have introduced some errors to it. The other topic that you might hear a lot is around the fit for purpose of particular data. So the reason why a data point is collected for might not be for you to do research or analytics or clinical decision support on it. For example, medical claims data is collected in order for a provider to be paid by a payer. It's not necessarily containing all of the elements that you need in order to do research. There's a lot of implementation challenges. Some of the biggest delays of making data useful that I've seen so far is to get data outside of electronic health records in a compliant way and then kind of like standardize and normalize that data. Even when you have data from one Epic instance to another Epic instance, if you've had different implementations, that data might not actually connect apples to each other. We'll talk a little bit more about kind of like that's value chain for healthcare data if you guys are curious. But the other thing that I think especially now in the age of generative AI models, a lot of the data that becomes super valuable is this multimodal data. So genomic imaging, voice data, et cetera, medical doctor notes data, which we considered unstructured data. And unstructured data has been always historically considered super messy. Most of the data that you see folks work with for research today is structured and tabular data. But I think in the world of AI, that's going to change. And then there's human error. A lot of actually like the messiness that you see in data is because somebody actually had a fat finger problem when they input the data to begin with. And speaking of allergies, this is one example that I like a lot, which is sometimes data gets originated into an EHR. You've seen your own physicians, click, click, click on these kind of cumbersome UI, and mistakes can happen. The two examples that we're showing here is you have two males of a certain age that have an allergy of a drug called Sisinal. So for those of you who are not familiar, Sisinal is a form of birth control. So obviously this is an error. It's not possible for a man of the age of 82 to have this allergy. It turns out that these individuals likely had seasonal allergies, and this was wrongly imputed. So not to discourage folks as you work with healthcare data, but one thing to always keep in mind is as you're working with data, if you see that some things are a little odd, going from data capture to data querying and data analyzing, a lot of things could have potentially gone wrong. I'm not going to go through this slide because I think this is something that folks, I'll make sure that these slides are available. I think this is something that folks can reference later. But again, going through the process that actually by the time you even feed data and fine-tune a potential AI model, that data might have had a lot of things that have happened to it that could have changed its flavor or could have changed its utility for good or for bad. That's all to say, though, I'm a huge believer in creating full and complete data sets because they actually help answer questions that were not able to be answered before. Creating longitudinal data sets, I've seen in my clients and I've seen in the research that I've done myself, can actually help solve so many open research questions today that would be difficult to solve with very active data collection. When you think about clinical trials, they run in the hundreds of millions of dollars. They go around for, let's say, 18 months to a couple of years. That's not enough information to create really a full story of what happens to those trial participants, for example. But if we let clinical trials run for 10, 15 years, the cost of them would be hugely prohibitive. So being able to follow patients passively in the real world and be able to still answer certain research questions to me is one of the most valuable and untapped problems or untapped challenges that we have out there, and one that in the next 5 to 10 years, I'm hopeful we'll see a lot of changes on. And beyond kind of like pharma and healthcare, one thing that I want to highlight is that good data can actually help solve many, if not all, analytic problems in healthcare. So if you are working in other legs of healthcare that are outside of pharma, which is my specialty, there are use cases where really good data can still help solve very, very important problems. So let me pause here because I've talked for quite a bit and see if folks have any questions before we pivot to AI meeting healthcare.
I think we have a lot of questions, but maybe we also want to.
Sure. So let me walk through kind of what I've seen and then what we've been thinking about when it comes to healthcare data and AI. First of all, advanced analytics, machine learning, et cetera, has been used to improve healthcare data for quite a while. We're talking a lot more about generative AI technologies right now, but I want to highlight that whether it's predictive AI or generative AI or just general advanced analytics, we need to think about the intersection of AI health and healthcare data in two different ways. You can have AI tools that help improve healthcare data, all the way from making sure that some of the problems that I mentioned earlier around standardization, normalization, figuring out where there's missing variables and trying to guess what those could have been, summarization of data, and making sort of more democratic approaches to data analytics for folks who might not know how to code. Those are all ways to improve raw healthcare data where AI, I think, is going to be super valuable. In my experience, one of the most important ways that AI and machine learning has helped me and my company improve data is around this data connectivity problem. So we help connect de-identified data. So our technology is able to tell you that patient 1, 2, 3 in this data set and patient 4, 5, 6 in this other data set are the same individual without you needing to know that that individual is Vera or Jimang or somebody else. In order to do that super well, you need to have identity resolution technology that does it super well. So as people, let's say, get married and change their last names or might have certain personally identifiable information that's not found in different data sets, how do you make sure that you can link that data together correctly, especially if that data is only available to you in a pre-de-identified way through like different patient keys that are cryptographic hashes of personally identifiable information. So even from that perspective, how do you link two data sets together around the same identity? Machine learning has helped us quite a bit to be able to do that better over time. So AI tools can improve healthcare data. The thing that I hear a lot of folks talk more about today is how can healthcare data train and fine-tune AI models for healthcare-specific use cases. So obviously, we're all familiar with the ChatGPTs of the world and how large language models have been trained on, you know, the corpus of data. Are there certain use cases for which training those models with healthcare-specific data can help answer better questions around clinical decision making or around improving efficiency of healthcare operations? So is there a world where healthcare data can actually make AI models for healthcare better? I think the answer is yes. There's kind of like two schools of thought where for certain things and for answering certain questions, training on just the corpus of available data out there is probably enough. Training certain models in the corpus of available public data, so like the papers on PubMed, open repositories is enough. And then there's certain other things where if you're a hospital system and you're trying to improve the healthcare operations of that particular hospital, being able to train with your internal proprietary data might have a lot more value. So I want to talk a little bit about the second component, which is how do we use healthcare data to help make certain AI models or AI offerings better. One of the problems that I didn't touch on a lot here, but I'm sure you can imagine, is that there's lots of rules and regulations around how healthcare data can be used. Healthcare data is probably one of the most sensitive pieces of information about you out there. Financial data probably would be a second, but I would say it's a distant second. And there's lots of regulation that protects your healthcare data. In the US, it's HIPAA. Outside of the US, there's regulation like GDPR and others that protects data in general and your health data. Under HIPAA, there are a lot of reasons for why sharing data is very permissible. You might have heard the terms treatment, payment, and operations, where covered entities such as hospital systems, insurance companies, and then the companies that are in the middle of those two, the middleware companies that help payers and providers talk to each other, they have the ability to share identified data under certain permissible use cases. There's also a second part of HIPAA that is called the HIPAA privacy rule that allows for healthcare data to be shared for secondary research purposes. A lot of the data that you might be using in your own research is probably shared in this way. This data is allowed to be shared if and only if that data is considered de-identified. De-identified has a pretty unique meaning under HIPAA. A data set is considered de-identified if it's got a very low risk of re-identification of a particular patient. It doesn't tell you how low that risk is. It just tells you that there's two paths that you can kind of certify that something is de-identified. One is called the HIPAA safe harbor method, which some of you might have heard about. And the other one is called the expert determination method. Under Safe Harbor, there's I think 18 elements, 18 categories of data that you need to null out or roll up in order to consider that data sets de-identified under Safe Harbor. And a lot of research is done this way, but Safe Harbor actually eliminates a lot of the utility of that data. One of the things that you need to remove in order to use a data set under Safe Harbor is I believe it's date of service. So if you don't have date of service, you don't know when a patient was diagnosed with something or seen at a doctor for something, you're not going to be able to really conduct good longitudinal studies. And if you're kind of feeding that type of data to a model, you might not be able to train that model as accurately as you think you would. The second method is called the expert determination method, and that's the one that Datavant is super familiar with, which actually looks at a data set and has a statistician and statistical models to determine how big the risk is by looking at all of the data elements in that data set and certify that if you remediate some parts of the data set, if you, let's say, roll up date of birth to year of birth or roll up zip code to zip three area, you are lowering the risk of re-identifying any individual. So, said another way, no matter how you cut that data set, you're not creating a cell where you have one individual and you're able to say, aha, this is Vera, and then therefore you're increasing the risk in that data set. A lot of data is exchanged this way in a de-identified world today. And once you have one de-identified data set and you're trying to connect it to another one, you just go again through this expert determination method and you say, hey, now you added some data elements that are risky. Therefore, you need to do a little bit more changes to your data set in order for it to be considered again de-identified. Again, like when you have two, three, four data sets that you're combining together, this method works pretty well. You can still get an interesting data set with high data utility and with high privacy preservation. But now, what happens if you're going to take that data and you're going to feed it into an AI model? Now you're essentially linking it potentially to the rest of the world of data. What would happen if somebody was trying to, like prompt engineer, let's say like a chatbot to be able to feed back potentially identifying information about a patient? We believe that as you're adding healthcare data to these AI models, you might have heightened risk. So one of the things that I would recommend as folks are thinking about using de-identified healthcare data to train AI models is to have in mind, a lot of both access controls and testing for how your model will be used to make sure that you're thinking about privacy protection. So as you're building new models, as you're building new products, make sure that you do so with a privacy-centric mindset, so that the test inputs that you're using are properly thought about, so that the questions that could be asked of a particular model can keep privacy in mind. I don't think there's kind of like a good answer right now of like what is best practice for when you're adding healthcare data into a model. I think this is going to be a space where we and the industry will continue to have to do a lot more research. And I would say the one interesting thing is that privacy needs to be checked over time here. One of the best practices that I give folks is if you're creating something that has, or if you're putting something out in the world that has been trained and fine-tuned based on healthcare data, make sure that the access controls for it are also very, very robust so that it's used only by people who need to and only for purposes that they need to. And then everything that happens is logged and monitored accordingly. The second challenge beyond privacy is one around data completeness. As I mentioned earlier, if you're, like with AI models, there's a little bit of a garbage in, garbage out problem that I'm sure you guys recognize and appreciate. But when it comes to healthcare data, given that at steady state, healthcare data is super fragmented, it only tells you one piece of a puzzle of a patient's history. Once you aggregate some data together, if you're creating a data set that is not representative of the population that you intend to study, then that data set in and of itself would create a bias that could be propagated in your model. So when you're thinking about fit-for-purpose data, there are four categories that I recommend folks to think about when they choose what kind of data they're going to use to train a particular model. You want that data to be relevant, to be reliable, to be complete or representative, and to be longitudinal. I won't go bullet by bullet here, but when it comes to relevant data, I think the best example that I have is don't create a speech model without speech data. Like this is pretty obvious, but also don't use data that are kind of irrelevant to the question that you're trying to ask. So if you want to know outcomes, don't use just claims data. You need to perhaps use electronic health record data as well. On the reliability side, you know, make sure that you know where your data is coming from. There are lots of places and ways to license data as much as you can. And in many cases, you might not know who the raw data source or data originator is, but make sure you know how that data was put together. Was it, you know, like from one major data source, or was it a connection and collection of like 12, 15, 20 different data sources? Were there any standardizations that were done to the data? Is any of the data synthetic? Is any of the data imputed? On the completeness, if you want to make decisions on the entire US population, for example, and you're using data that, let's say, came only from cities or came only from, let's say, white 45-year-old men, then you're not being representative of the entire population. So ensure that the data that you have represents both the population that you're trying to study, the disease area that you're trying to study, and it's diverse in terms of rural versus city, in terms of race, in terms of ethnicity, in terms of gender, and in terms of age. And then for a lot of use cases, getting one point in time in the life of a patient or even a patient population is not enough. You want to be able to have longitudinal data long enough to be able to test a particular intervention that you have in mind. So for example, if you're trying to figure out how a patient population reacted to a drug before and after COVID, you want to make sure that, you know, like the COVID-19 pandemic was in your data set, and you want to have some data for years beforehand, and you want to have some data that is more recent. When I personally think about how healthcare data will change the AI world, I think a lot about privacy, and I think a lot about data completeness. And then when I'm kind of like, you know, over a coffee chat with my colleagues, we love to do predictions sometimes, and we love to think about what's going to happen in the future. These are, just for the fun of it, my like predictions for where I see healthcare and AI will go in the next decade. So I mentioned earlier that there's still an open question right now on whether you truly need healthcare data, specific and proprietary data, for a lot of the use cases. I think for some of them, it's totally necessary. For some others, out-of-the-box applications will be more than sufficient. I think what HIPAA, which was frankly created in 1996, which was before the world of even like electronification of medical records, let alone the AI world, I think HIPAA is necessary, but probably not sufficient when it comes to thinking about privacy best practices. Frankly, even getting to the HIPAA bar, I think would be great for a lot of the data out there that's, you know, exchanged outside of HIPAA confines. But I think we need to do more and to go above and beyond that. In terms of use cases that I think will be kind of low-hanging fruit of how healthcare data can help AI, there are certain tasks right now that have to do with healthcare operations, like medical coding or like prior authorization before kind of like an expensive procedure can happen. I believe that those will be fully automated, and there will be very little kind of like human in the loop in them. There is kind of a pessimist would say that if I'm looking at prior authorization and I have physicians, providers on one hand, and I have payers in the other, physicians could have an AI model that makes the case for your prior authorization. Payers could have an AI model that makes a case for whether you're going to approve or not approve a particular intervention. And then it's going to be AI versus AI, and it's going to be a cycle of, you know, what happens in the end? Will the world be better or not when it comes to improving healthcare operations? The one thing that I'm pretty sure is that we are not going to be in a world where physicians, where caretakers, where your nurses, where your family members will be completely replaced by automated tools. Like that's not a place that I think we'll be at, and frankly not a place that I think we'll want to be at. And then the last three here are maybe a little bit more out there. If I was an investor today, if I was a venture capitalist, I would invest as much money in AI companies today as I would in actually middleware companies. So companies that help with access controls, that help with making sure that AI models are actually interacting with other pieces of software in a way that is appropriate, in a way that is trackable, and in a way that's loggable. I put an article here that talks about that. And from a scientist perspective, I'd love to see AI discovered drugs to market. I'd love to see all the work that I did in my undergrad and in my PhD be kind of like solved in days or weeks using technology. That would be amazing. That will bring so much diversity of different treatments and get us to truly personalized medicine if we want it to be. And then finally, one place where I see a lot of potential for automation is in surgeries. I always joke that we'll have fully autonomous robotic surgeries before we have fully autonomous cars. And as somebody who hates how to drive, I'm a little sad about this, but I see where we're kind of like the world of medical operations is going, and medical devices, and being able to train based on the corpus of historical medical surgeries is kind of a fascinating space to me. So I'm curious actually if we get to talk about, or if you guys want to put in chats, what are your predictions or what do you wish would happen in the next decade because we have these technologies and because we have healthcare data. And with that, thank you for listening to me today. Sorry if some of this was a little out of left field, given some of the things that you think about on a day-to-day basis. But I hope that as you're thinking about your lessons, you think a lot about healthcare data, where it can be useful, how it can be useful, and how can we make sure that technology can help make data more useful. So I'll stop there.
Thank you. Thank you for this is awesome. There's just so many interesting thoughts and insights in your talks. Thanks for sharing the slide as well. So we'll do Q&A now. In fact, I asked my students Benjamin Danek to co-host this part. So he can, in fact, I shared with you the some of the question that he put together for in preparation for this. And I mean, during the your presentation, we also added a whole bunch of additional question that we came up with. Maybe Benjamin, you want to introduce yourself and maybe ask the first question?
Yeah. Hey, it's nice to meet you. I'm Benjamin. Really amazing presentation, like Jumeng said. Just kind of, I have two questions. I think so. The first one's kind of closely aligned with what you guys do at Datavant. So you mentioned that you use cryptographic methods to enable patient linking. You obviously work on scientific research as well on behalf of the company, and you evaluate all kinds of methodologies. I was curious if you guys had looked at approaches like synthetic data or federated learning or maybe differential privacy, something, some other ML methods that may be able to enable this and provide other kind of characteristics.
Yeah, no, nice to meet you as well, Benjamin. And that's a great question. So, yes, we have. And I think those technologies can actually open up the total addressable market of what you can do with data, not just on the business side, but actually what data can be put in play for certain use cases. So, what we do today is for folks who are comfortable bringing data together in a de-identified way. Our technology is very simple. We call it tokenization. It's a way of essentially taking identity, transforming it into a cryptographic hash. And when the hash is matched, you have simplistically, you have an identity. But that implies that people are willing to share data with each other and for data to sit in one place. That is true for a lot of data. That's not true for all data. Some of the things that we're seeing right now is folks using what's called clean room technology. So be able to hold your own data in your premises. Let's say you have them on Databricks or AWS or Snowflake, have folks be able to answer questions of that data without necessarily the data exchanging hands or without necessarily the data moving. So you have control of your data. people can get utility out of that. You can, you know, like you can get paid, you can get licensed for it. So there are ways to do kind of federated question asking of data that we're seeing more and more. We're seeing that a lot when you're trying to actually connect clinical data to consumer data that, you know, advertisers usually have used on you or SDOH, socioeconomic and demographic data, that in for many reasons, there's a lot of risk in putting that data together from a privacy perspective. On the differential privacy, we've seen, and there's a number of technologies out there that use it, that sort of like apply those tools. Again, like we see more of the application there for data that are, for whatever reason, difficult to put in one place. One of the interesting examples that I've seen kind of like on the federated side of the world is actually with chemical data. A number of pharma companies who obviously compete with each other on their pipelines and on their assets have very proprietary chemical data sets that they don't want to share with other pharma companies, but they all want to benefit out of the shared knowledge and then training machine learning models on that data. So those are kind of use cases where more federated approaches to getting information out of data are out there. It's a lot more difficult to do that kind of work today. Like in practice, I think it's like super easy to say like, hey, let's use federated learning. In theory, in practice, I think because of standardization and normalization of data, it's not as easy, but I'm very, very keen to see that space go. And then the other one, which is synthetic data, which is let's solve the privacy problem by not having a patient's actual data be used. I find that space super compelling, and we've done a few partnerships in the space with folks who are experts in the area. There's still an open question of like, how do you convince folks that this synthetic data is privacy preserving? And that is our privacy team actually does a lot of research in that space, and that's still kind of an open question out there. I think we'll see more application of synthetic data in places like Europe, where GDPR is a lot more stringent around healthcare data exchange than even HIPAA is in the US. One open question that I have about that is on the regulatory side. So I spend a lot of time thinking about how can we use real-world data for regulatory decision-making, for bringing new drug approvals to market, or having even extended approvals of certain drugs to new interventions. The FDA has just started to think in the past 5 to 7 years about how to use real-world data, like actual real-world data from patients for regulatory decision-making. And their bar is like, my hand will go above the screen here. It's super high. It's the same bar that they use for clinical trials. There's lots of guidances that they published out there that are super informative. So I feel right now that we're getting regulators to just like wrap their head around real-world data and where it can be beneficial, where perhaps, you know, like we're asking too much out of real-world data. Layering synthetic data on top of it is going to be a few more years. I think there's going to be a lot of research and demonstration studies to ensure that you can actually prove that insights gotten out of synthetic data are appropriate for, you know, causal inference type of studies. And I don't think we've actually even proven it for at scale for raw real world data itself, let alone for synthetic data. Super interesting, but I think for certain use cases we're a little bit.
And kind of adjacent to that, like large language models and kind of the current style of AI, it has kind of undeniable benefits in all kinds of domains. I mean, how do you think that's going to impact the way that regulatory agencies are going to treat AI?
Very, very hot topic for debate right now. And I think both FDA and EMEA in Europe issued a few guidances on this. One thing that I hadn't appreciated is how many AI tools are already FDA approved and FDA regulated. I think it's over 400, but they're all in the predictive AI world. So like, how do you read a radiology scan better? Generative AI is adding like a lot more complexity because you can't really regulate a Gen AI model in the same way that you could a piece of software that can be used to read radiology images, for example, because these models change with time. Whereas like a piece of software, you could say, this is the version that was FDA approved. Don't upgrade it if you were going to upgrade it. It might need to go through various other approvals. If something will end up being considered software as medical device, obviously it has to go through the regulatory process and get some approval. I don't know yet, jury's still out on how exactly the approval process will go. I think some of the stuff that was done in the past to validate certain models might not be relevant or even feasible or possible anymore. So I'm curious to see where the industry will go, but certainly something that will come to a head in the next couple of years.
So maybe I can ask a follow-up question, Benjamin. And you in your prediction wish list, you mentioned drug discovery, and also we heard about you talk about this clinical trial use cases for long-term follow-up. In this clinical trial drug discovery space, what do you think are some biggest opportunity for AI and to innovate or apply?
So one that I really like that I'm curious to see if like the commercials around it will make it possible is around new antibiotic discovery. So drug-resistant bacteria is a huge problem, and one where actually with the overuse of antibiotics right now is one that could be a serious population health problem globally in the same way a viral pandemic was. There's not as much investment, or there hasn't been historically as much investment in novel antibiotic structures. And I think AI can essentially become your chemistry PhD student in a box and potentially be able to dream up or investigate new structures that we haven't thought of before. That's a space that I think is super interesting. So be able to bring new chemical structures to market for some use cases where actually developing new drugs is prohibitively expensive, the standard way of doing drug development. And I mentioned antibiotics because, you know, they're ones that are used ideally for a short period of time, so not chronically, and there's not that much, you know, money in that space. So I think being able to discover new antibiotics cheaper and in a more automated and faster way whenever we encounter resistance, I think it's going to be super interesting. On the other end, deeply personalized medicine is another one where I'm very, very excited to see how AI and drug discovery can help, not just in bringing new drugs to market, but bringing better combinations and bringing also reusability to drugs that are already in the shelves. So patient shows up with, let's say like lung cancer, we're able to do tumor sequencing right now, being able to say that for this particular individual with this particular historical course of therapy and this tumor burden or tumor mutation, here's the cocktail of combination of drugs, and here's the order in which they should be given in order to get the best outcome for that particular patient. So truly personalized medicine is also another place that I think it's going to be super interesting to see where AI can help. And just generally speaking, there's modality, like we use obviously the scientific method and certain dogmas that have been passed along over time to how we discover drugs. I think even 50 years ago that there was the central dogma in biology that said DNA makes RNA makes protein. Now we know that RNA can also make DNA, but people weren't thinking about it because it wasn't in their corpus of research. I wonder every day, what are some of the things that like are ingrained in our heads today as we do drug discovery that might either A, not be true, or B, not be relevant to new drug discovery? So I'd love to see sort of the craziest type of intervention that can be discovered via AI that like scientifically, like somebody going into a lab today, even with, you know, like whole genome sequencing, transcriptomic, proteomic, et cetera, like might not be thinking about in a hypothesis-based way.
Yeah, interesting, definitely. I mean, Benjamin, you want to ask a follow-up question? Or I know.
Yeah. So kind of given that maybe the landscape of what's known is changing quite a bit and all kinds of opportunities are coming up in applications for developing new methods in healthcare. If you were a PhD student again, what kind of skills would you cultivate to capture this very interesting period in time and maybe even just broadly prepare you for industry research?
That's an excellent question. I was thinking about that a lot. I would say wherever you are in your PhD journey, like whether you're a bench scientist or somebody who's more on the technology side, try to be bilingual. So if you know a lot about computer science, bioinformatics, try to learn some of the clinical and more bench science, and vice versa. I was more of a lab experiment, wet lab bench scientist. I wish I'd spent more time learning how to actually analyze and work with big data. The second best thing you can do is to partner with folks who do that, so that you can, you can build a corpus of your publications that has both bioinformatic and wet lab information in your research. The other thing that I would do, actually, if your question is like, how do you become more, more prepared for being in industry, for being in startups, is to actually learn about just basic presentation skills. I would say spend a lot of time going to conferences, giving presentations outside of your lab, do things that are more extracurricular. I would say it's well worth to spend time being in your student government as you're learning about kind of like making the case for what you want and need, because doing that and being strategic about the way you communicate is just as valuable as your scientific skills in the real world.
Yeah.
Benjamin, ask a last question.
Yeah. Last question is basically, how did you how did you really make the choice to do PhD then to small startup? I mean, it's I think lots of us are in the middle of the PhD or the beginning of research. So how do you go about making that decision?
So that decision is super personal, and frankly, it changes over time. When I joined my PhD, I was dead set I was going to be an academic researcher. I was going to be a basic researcher, and nobody could have changed my mind. And PhD for me was 5 years. Midway through that, I looked at my mentor, who I very much respected and worshipped, and she had studied the same protein for the past 20 years and loved it. And I just learned that for myself, that was not the thing that I was going to be able to do or that would give me enough intellectual satisfaction. I knew I wanted to do a little bit of everything. And actually, before getting to know that I wanted to be in the startup world, I spent 3 years or so as a consultant, just learning the industry, just learning kind of like what's out there outside of academia. So the choice was personal. I think like as you continue your career, try a little bit of everything, and you're going to find something that sticks for you and where you find a lot more of your own personal energy and interest, and then pursue it.
Okay. Awesome. Thank you.
That's great. So now we have 2 more minutes. I can ask the real last question then. So maybe on the maybe more on the prediction side, what do you think is the biggest surprise that in AI for healthcare application that not yet happened, right? You think, oh, this should by now should have happened, right? But still not. But what are those biggest surprise sets to you?
So, and we were chatting actually about this a couple of weeks ago. It's clinical abstraction. I think taking information from like this messy PDFs or printouts that come out of electronic medical records and making it useful without somebody manually annotating it, I'm very surprised that that hasn't been solved for yet. Even companies like Flatiron Health and some others like in the oncology space that have been kind of like experts in this space, they still do like tech-enabled abstraction as opposed to like service tech and service-enabled abstraction as opposed to like being able to feed data and get kind of like structured and curated tables out of it. In practice or in theory, it feels like it's a problem that would be very easily solvable by AI, but there's so much complexity to it and like what good really looks like what is 99% precision and recall in abstracting a data set, that it has surprised me it hasn't been solved yet. I feel like we're very, very close to solving it, and I'm very curious to see where this space goes.
Okay, that makes sense. I think that's one topic which we'll work on maybe together. Thanks. Okay. I know we're run out of time here. Thanks, Vera, for your time, for the wonderful talk, and thanks for sharing your thoughts and experience with our students. Thank you.
My pleasure. Thank you for having me.
Hi.
Thank you.